Thank you. Good afternoon. Can I start by reminding members that COVID-related measures are in place in the Chamber and around the Holyrood campus. Face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the campus. The next item of business is portfolio questions. And portfolio questions this afternoon is education and skills. Can I remind members who want to ask a supplementary to press the request to speak buttons or put R in the chat function during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Bill. To ask the Scottish Government what the recruitment policy is for its education agencies in light of the plan to abolish the SQA and reform Education Scotland.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Sunmother.
There has been no change to the recruitment policy for education agencies following my announcement to replace the SQA and reform Education Scotland. This remains a matter for the individual agencies and is publicly available in Education Scotland and the SQA's framework agreement. I am committed to the continued support for the SQA and Education Scotland to ensure they have sufficient resources to meet their functions during this transitional period.
Russell Finlay.
I've been looking at many job adverts for the soon-to-be-overhauled Education Scotland. The Quango is right now looking for a head of leadership learning. Apparently, and I quote, this person will lead and coordinate the work of the Professional Learning and Leadership Directorate, providing national support for professional learning and leadership development. The head of leadership learning will work closely together with the head of professional leadership and learning to bring a coherent approach to professional learning and leadership learning and development on a local, regional and national basis. Sorry, that wasn't my fault. That was their advert.
I know you're making your point.
I know
you're
making a question. Now, this lucky person will get up to £77,000 a year for this role. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain the benefits of these lucrative Quango jobs to pupils and parents? And would this money not be better spent on teachers?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this government is investing very heavily in additional teachers, and within the first 100 days alone, we have made that commitment and we have taken action upon it. Education Scotland and the SQA continue to have exceptionally important roles supporting teachers to support our learners during this transitional phase, and I trust that all of those working in Education Scotland and those who will reply to the job advertisements that are available will do their utmost to support our education system through this difficult time, supporting our teachers to support our learners.
On the assumption they're not going to read out job descriptions, two brief supplementaries. Martin Whitfield first, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. No job description, but could I ask the Cabinet Secretary to undertake today that she will wholly fund the new agency from the Scottish Government rather than require it to raise resources, as the current SQA must do, diverting attention from its core purpose?
Cabinet Secretary.
The remit and role and functions of the replacement to the SQA is something that will be, of course, reported on by Ken Muir, who is due to report to me back in January. The ability for the Scottish Qualifications Authority to seek recompense from local authorities and is not something that is something that's alone to Scotland. But if Ken Muir wishes to put in a submission on these issues, or indeed anyone wants to put in submissions to Ken Muir as he carries on that work, I'm sure he'll listen closely to that, and I will listen closely to the recommendations that come from that.
And Willie Rennie.
Will it be possible to recruit staff who are able to produce timely guidance, unlike yesterday's guidance, that notes that further guidance will be produced in October for this year's qualifications, 2 months in to the school year? How on earth does that help pupils and teachers?
Cabinet Secretary.
The first guidance actually came out before the summer holidays. This is an additional measure that gives additional detail to that. I think it's quite right that the SQA are working with stakeholders through the National Qualifications Group to look at what guidance can be put in place and then put that out as expeditiously as possible once that has been agreed. Now, I think that's rather sensible of the SQA to do that in stages when there is agreement reached, rather than waiting too long, because often the SQA and other organisations are criticised for taking too long on these approaches. Now, the contingencies that the SQA gave further detail on yesterday have stressed the fact that there is no increased workload, for example, for teachers, which I think was a very useful and, I hope, reassuring statement that the SQA put out. And I think they were quite right to do that in the quickest way as they have. And they will, as they say, provide further guidance in due course once that has gone through the stakeholder consultation through the NQ group.
Question number two, Fiona Hislop.
To ask the Scottish Government what information and resources schools will provide to engage pupils with the issues that will be discussed at COP26.
Cabinet Secretary.
While it is, of course, a matter for schools and authorities to decide the details of how to engage with COP26, Education Scotland is coordinating a package of learning materials and live online engagement with schools, education authorities and national partner agencies. Schools are also supported to engage with COP26 through the Scottish Government-funded Eco Schools and Climate Ready Classrooms initiatives, which support schools in planning action on climate change and other environmental issues through providing resources and training for educators and pupils.
Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government may be aware that of the Scottish Youth Film Foundation's COP TV programme, which will feature films and interviews created by young people from all over Scotland during COP26. COP TV will be broadcast into schools across the USA due to the Foundation's partnership with the New York Times. Will the Cabinet Secretary be willing to liaise with the Foundation's organisers and with Education Scotland to ensure that this programming is also made available to pupils in Scotland, and can she offer any assistance so that the young people involved with COP TV can access the conference of youth taking place?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I was delighted to hear about the Scottish Youth Film Foundation's COP TV programme, and we're working with the organisations across Scotland, including YoungGo, the UN's official youth constituency, who are, of course, hosting the Conference of Youth, to ensure that children and young people in Scotland have as many opportunities as possible to make their voices heard on the global stage. Education Scotland is liaising with the Scottish Youth Film Foundation to explore how young people can engage with COP through their plans, and Screen Scotland is also providing funding towards the Climate Challenge 1.5 degrees films project, working with Films Access Scotland and other partners to support climate change filmmaking with young people in eco schools.
Thank you. Question number three, Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what analysis it has carried out of any sectorial skills and labour shortages in Scotland following Brexit.
Mr Jamie Hepburn.
The Scottish Government Office of the Chief Economic Advisor has been working closely with Skills Development Scotland to carry out analysis of official labour market sources to provide insights into sectoral skills and labour shortages in Scotland following Brexit. In July, I, along with the Minister for Just Transition, Employment and Fair Work and the Minister for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise, met with a number of business representative organisations to better understand their recruitment challenges, many of which have been directly linked to the UK Government's immigration policy. We've continued to engage with business on mitigation measures, and we continue to press the UK Government to hear the concerns being raised and to act accordingly.
Paul McLennan.
Can I thank the Minister for his answer? Brexit has impacted on many sectors in my constituency, leaving many businesses with skill shortages and increasing labour shortages. Can I ask what discussions have been held with the UK Government in regards to its post-Brexit immigration scheme, and in particular to Tier 2 entry requirements? And does he agree with me that the best solution to this in the future is an independent Scotland that can make its own arrangements?
Minister.
Well, as I set out in my initial answer, we do seek to engage with the UK Government on these matters regularly. For instance, Richard Lochhead wrote to the UK Government in July on the post-Brexit immigration policy, urging them to rethink this in light of skills shortages. Mary Guzan wrote in August to highlight some of the challenges in the food and drink sector. Where we are now, I believe that the UK Government should be considering the paper we've pulled together, Migration Helping Scotland Prosper, which outlines how devolution of migration could work. But of course, I agree with the member, independence is ultimately the best way to shape an immigration policy fit for Scotland's circumstances.
Thank you. Question number four, Stephen Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government what impact the COVID-19 pandemic has had on the positive destinations of school leavers.
Minister.
The Scottish Government has responded to concerns about the impact that the pandemic has had on young people by introducing the Young Persons Guarantee, providing £70 million of funding this year in addition to the £60 million allocated last year. The 2019-20 data showed that 92.2% of school leavers were in a positive destination at the nine-month point after the end of the school year. The 2021 figures will be available in due course.
Stephen Kerr.
I thank the Minister for his reply. In Falkirk, the number of apprenticeships has dropped from 587 last year to 160 this year. And this is a fall that's replicated right across the country. So without whataboutery and without any defensiveness, does the Minister recognise this is a disaster for young people, a disaster for businesses, and a disaster for all of us? Is he satisfied that enough is being done to address this issue?
Minister.
What satisfies me is the positive news that, yes, of course, we saw a significant impact on the number of apprentices being recruited in the last year. How could we have had anything but, given we're in a global pandemic and demand was suppressed? But what we have seen in the first quarter of this year is 3.7 times the number of modern apprenticeship starts at the same time last year, in quarter one of the year before. So we are recovering. In relation to his question about whataboutery, I take that as a reference to what's happening in here in Scotland by comparison to the rest of the UK. So I'll update the Chamber in regards to that. In 2016-17, we had 26,262 apprenticeship starts by 2019-20, 27,875. That's up. In England, by contrast, in the same period, they declined by 172,400 apprenticeship starts.
Thank you. And brief supplementary, CoCab Stewart, who joins us online.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting Scotland's young people into employment, education or training.
Minister.
Well, of course, we have a range of initiatives underway. We have our developing the young workforce activity, which is now well embedded and now being accelerated and enhanced by the near 300 DYW school coordinators that are employed in every secondary school in Scotland. And of course, we have the Young Persons Guarantee that I have mentioned, which will provide at least 24,000 new and enhanced employment education and training opportunities over a two-year period, in addition to all of the activity we already had in place.
Thank you, Minister. Question number five, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what measures it's putting in place to support outdoor education.
Mr. Clare Hawkey.
In addition to the £2.5 million we provided to the sector over the last 18 months, we work with the sector on an ongoing basis to support schools to access and use outdoor centres and ensure that our COVID-19 guidance provides clear advice on safe, supported visits to centres. The most recent update to that guidance was on the 19th of August to remove caps on the numbers of young people within dorms and tents. The programme for government contains a number of further commitments to trial Scotland's first outdoor primary learning facilities to provide support for children to go on curriculum-related trips, including primary 6 and 7 residentials, and to give secondary school pupils the right to go on at least one optional trip during their time at school.
Liz Smith.
Could I thank the Minister for that update? However, one of the most urgent concerns remains the future viability of around a third of our outdoor education centres, and even more importantly, the future employment of the very highly specialised members of their staff, whose skills are absolutely crucial to the education of our young people, most especially after the COVID pandemic. So can I press the Scottish Government as to what it is doing to secure the future of our outdoor education centres?
Minister.
I thank Liz Smith for that question. She may well be interested to know that on the 10th of August, I met with the Outward Bounds Trust, Scotland's Scouts, and the chair of the Association of Heads of Outdoor Education Centres. And some of the issues that she's raised today were raised during that meeting. And it was agreed that officials would follow up in order to gather more detailed information and evidence. And a further meeting between officials is being arranged for the next few weeks.
I'm going to call a supplementary for Colette Stevenson if it's on outdoor education.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it's taken to ensure that the climate emergency is reflected in the learning of our children and young people.
I call on the Minister to tie that back into outdoor education.
Our Learning for Sustainability Action Plan, which comprises climate education, contains actions to support teacher skills in sustainability education, to develop and promote qualifications relating to sustainability, and to encourage schools to take a whole school approach. To coincide with the COP26 summit, Education Scotland is providing a series of online countdown to COP events to schools, and the Learning for Sustainability Awards 2021, which will be announced on the 27th of October, will also help to gather and share examples of sustainability education across Scotland, and I'm sure that will include outdoor education, Presiding Officer.
Saved at the last. Question number 6, Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will take forward the recommendation of Professor Gordon Stobart's review of upper secondary education student assessment in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Professor Stobart's work looks at approaches to qualifications and assessment taken around the world and sets out options for consideration in a Scottish context. We will draw on this work to inform wider conversations and ensure that our future qualifications and assessment approaches better align with the early stages of our curriculum and are accessible for all learners, including those with additional support needs and those from more deprived backgrounds. I will provide a further update to Parliament in October as part of an update on the ongoing implementation of the OECD's recommendations from their review of Curriculum for Excellence.
Bob Dorris.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Professor Stobart's international comparisons between high-stakes exit examinations and robust and adequately moderated continuous assessments highlights real opportunities to rebalance Scotland's model of certification to be less reliant on such high-stakes exams. Presiding Officer, having spoken with members of the Scottish Youth Parliament, with fellow members of the Education Committee just yesterday, I know this is something many young people would not only welcome, but be keen to be involved in shaping. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide any additional update to Parliament on the Scottish Government's latest thinking in this particular area? And can they reassure young people that they will be involved meaningfully in discussions around reshaping Scotland's model of certification to help ensure young people receive the qualifications they rightly merit?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we are very much committed as a government to ensuring the voices of young people, parents and teachers, as well as practitioners, are at the centre of our education policy. And we want it to be the norm for children and young people to be involved in the decision-making process in Scotland. On the 22nd of June, I outlined that we will reconvene the Scottish Education Council, and we will ensure the Council includes young persons' representatives. And in addition, we are establishing the Children and Young People's Education Council to sit alongside the Scottish Education Council and to give that parity of esteem. This, as well as wider engagement, will help to ensure that children and young people's voice influences education policy, including shaping any reform on qualifications.
Thank you. A couple of supplementaries. First, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary shouldn't need a further review or committee to answer this yes or no question. Can she give a simple guarantee that Scottish pupils will still have the opportunity to gain an externally assessed exam-based qualification before leaving school?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I've said on numerous occasions, this government is open to the opportunities that we have. Well, it's not a simple or yes or no answer, with the greatest of respect, Mr Mundell, because what we are doing is actually having a serious and detailed conversation about what assessments will look like. So yes and no doesn't quite cut it when you're in government. It might do for Mr Mundell's press release. As I was saying, Presiding Officer, this government is very, very open to looking at the best way of doing assessments and qualifications in the future. I think what Professor Hobart has given us is a range of options. Now, many of the opportunities that we have is to combine assessments at the end of term, exams, with more continuous assessment, ensuring that we give everyone within Scotland the opportunity to develop to their full potential. That's something that I am determined to do. I certainly hope the opposition rise to the occasion to get past yes or no answers and have a detailed conversation, including on exams and their role within the current setup and in any future setup, and how we can actually take this to the next level to provide the best opportunity for Scotland's young people.
And Michael Mara.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Yesterday, the SQA published a two-page document stating that final decisions over the national qualifications in 2022 will be made next March. It lacked any detail over what criteria will be used to make that decision, particularly whether disruption will be based on a pupil-by-pupil, school-by-school, council-by-council, or on a national basis of assessment. Will the Education Secretary give a statement to Parliament to clarify this very important issue?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think what the SQA said in their statement yesterday was to give further detail in what will happen under different scenarios. The aspect that they looked at is in scenario one, where there will be increased disruption, but exams will still be allowed to happen. And those changes can be made to very late on in the process, because it's about what will happen in the exams themselves. The other scenario which they looked at is, of course, if exams can't happen because of the pandemic, and that's exactly why they've given the reassurance that this is about assessments to inform process, but that it will not require any additional workload for teachers. So I think yesterday's announcement gave a lot of certainty and a lot of reassurance to both teachers, to young people and to parents. Of course, as we go through this year, it's a fluid and a flexible situation. I'm not sure if Mr Mara has a crystal ball to know what the pandemic will look like in a couple of months' time, but I certainly don't. So that's why we're continuing our discussion with stakeholders, why the SQA are continuing their discussion with stakeholders, including parents, teachers and with young people, to ensure that we develop our understanding as we go. And of course the SQA will give further detail in due course once those discussions have reached a point of making announcements.
Question 7, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government how it supports schools in delivering high quality education for children with additional support needs.
Cabinet Secretary.
We are committed to ensuring that all children and young people get the additional support that they need to reach their full potential. We published our joint response to the independently chaired review of implementation of additional support for learning in October 2020. Angela Morgan's report sets a clear direction in how we will continue to work with partners to build on progress in this area, and the joint action plan sets out the measures we will take to implement her recommendations.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. Due to CAMHS waiting times, Borders parents whose children live with ASN have been expressing how they find it difficult to gain a diagnosis, with some having to pay for a private assessment. Even then, private assessments are sometimes not accepted. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, in light of these difficulties, what additional resources can be made available to ensure more assessments are done so that children with ASN can receive the appropriate educational arrangements they are entitled to?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Rachel Hamilton for that question, and if she would wish to provide my office with further details about the specific local concerns that she's raised, I would be more than happy to provide further detail on that, on the local circumstances. But she is absolutely right to point out that children and young people have been adversely affected by the pandemic. That, of course, includes children with additional support needs and those who may be waiting on diagnosis. There is additional funding that has gone in to support local authorities and health boards, and there has been additional support going into the CAMHS service itself. But if Rachel Hamilton has a particular issue in her local area, as I said, I'd be more than happy to follow that up with her.
Okay, I want to take two supplementaries. They'll need to be very brief, and the answers likewise. Firstly, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps have been taken so far in appointing a Commissioner for Learning Disabilities, Autism and Neurodiversity, and what role that Commissioner is expected to play in ensuring a high quality level of education for children with these specific additional support needs.
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
So, as the First Minister announced in her programme for government, we are carrying out scoping work on the remit and powers of the Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill in this parliamentary year, and that will include the work on a Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Commissioner.
Thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government to set out its plan for a transition strategy, which it was committed to in the recent programme for government.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Pam Duncan-Glancy for the question? I know this is something that she is particularly keen to press the government on and ensure that we are delivering on. We have made progress on the work with that in terms of meeting with stakeholders and working groups. I know that there has been recent meetings on this. I wasn't at that one particularly myself, so I will ensure the minister involved, which I think was Claire Hawkey, as part of that work with Christina McKelvey, and we can get further detail on that for you.
And final question, Tess White.
Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work of the Mental Health in Schools Working Group.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Mental Health in Schools Working Group has overseen the development of new resources for school staff, including a new online professional learning resource, which was introduced in June 2021, and new guidance to support whole school approaches to mental health and wellbeing, which was published in August 2021. The resources helped school staff to understand and respond to the range of mental health and wellbeing concerns that young people may experience. The Scottish Government will continue to work with the Mental Health in Schools Working Group to embed these approaches right across Scotland.
And Tess White.
Cabinet Secretary, the Working Group's whole school approach framework includes access to school counselling services. However, Aberdeenshire Council has identified a shortage of qualified and accredited counsellors in the North East, which means that the counselling service will not be at full capacity until January 2023. Given the pressures on the children's mental health, what action is the Scottish Government taking to support the delivery of school counselling services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as Ms White will know, the Scottish Government has provided support to local authority partners to ensure that every secondary school has access to counselling services, because we want to make sure that those who require that support will do so. If there are particular workload issues in obtaining staff in particular areas, then clearly that is a concern. Then we will ensure that all the measures that can be taken at a Scottish Government level to improve access to those services is undertaken and will be undertaken, working, of course, with our local authority partners who have the responsibility for recruitment and retention in these issues.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That now concludes portfolio questions.